So have you completed this week's Excel challenge? Easy, right? Well, check out how Excel MVP Alan Murray, also known as Computergaga, approached the challenge with the following step-by-step instructions.
Okay, let's look at how we can achieve this. And the first step is to convert the range of sales data into a table. This is heavily encouraged, and it's going to make our analysis dynamic. Tables will automatically expand when new data, like our test data, is added to that range. So I'm going to select the range I would like to convert, use the keyboard shortcut Control T, check the range is correct and that the table does have headers, and click OK. That will apply the default style. So if I click in the table to activate the table design tab above, in the styles gallery, I'm going to select the option of clear so that I still have the table, but I don't have any of the styles applied. Then, as advised by Ken on the course, we will name the table. It's good to get into the practice of naming your table immediately after formatting a range as one. So far left of table design, it's currently named table 1. I'm going to name it sales. And then we can get on with the task of extracting the region from the reference column. Now for this, we are going to use some text functions. And because the region is in the middle of that reference, it is sandwiched between two hyphen characters, we are going to use the text function named mid. Now there are nearly always multiple solutions to a challenge such as this, but using formulas, mid is a function built for this purpose. It will prompt us for the text, and that is cell A2. It will use our table references now, so we'll reference it as @ref, the name of the column in this table. A comma moves us on to the start num argument, and this requires some work. The data in that column is irregular. I know the region will follow that number at the beginning of the cell content, but that number is irregular. It's sometimes 4 characters, sometimes 3, and even sometimes 2. And we need a pattern to identify the starting position of the region. Now on the course, Ken showed a function called find and also a function called search. We could use either in this scenario, but the goal is to use the hyphen character as the delimiter and as a way of identifying where the number ends and the region begins. And you may remember that the difference between find and search is that find is case sensitive. Because we're searching for a hyphen, we don't need to worry about the case of the character. So I'm going to use the search function, but find would also complete this task quite comfortably. Search will prompt for what text we want to find, and the answer to that is the hyphen. We will enclose it in the double quotes to denote a string. Comma, where are we searching for that hyphen? That is @ref. And then one more comma brings us on to the optional argument of where to start the search for the hyphen. Now there are actually 2 hyphens in that column. We are looking for the first instance of one, so it doesn't really matter about our answer here. We could leave it blank and it will start from the first character, which is what we want. However, although that works and it's an optional argument, I'm going to answer it anyway by typing in 1 to indicate to start from the first character in that cell. A closed bracket for the search function, and that will find the position of the hyphen. But we don't want the hyphen, we want the first character of the region. And that is 1 character after the hyphen, so +1 will give us the position of that character. A comma brings us on to the third and the final argument for the mid function, how many characters? And the answer for that is 3. Each region has a consistent 3 characters in length. Close bracket, then enter. Because our data is in a table, that will complete the column without us having to fill down, and we have the regions. Now let's move on to finding the total sales by those regions. Starting from G7, you may guess that we need the function SUMIF, or SUMIFS. We only have one condition here, so I'm going to use SUMIF. Equals SUMIF, open bracket, and it prompts us for the range that we are testing. If you are using SUMIFS, remember that begins with the range you are summing. Okay, the range we are testing is the region, the column that we just created, and it's in a table. So I'm going to select the table column by positioning my mouse over the table column header, looking for that black arrow, and clicking. We could also type that reference in. Comma brings us to criteria, and I will select the column to the left, known as F7, currently with DEU in as the region. A comma brings us to the sum range, and I will select the column with the values to sum, which is the amount. Close bracket, enter that, and we will need to fill it down because this is not in a table. Well, not for me, you may have done that. With that task complete, it's now time to find the number of sales that have met or exceeded the target of 2,500. Now, this is going to be a count if, because we want to know how many sales met that condition. So equals count if. Once again, we could choose count ifs, but we only have one condition. So if I go for the singular, we are prompted for the range that we're testing, and that is the amount column, using my table column selector, comma, and the criteria in this example is a combination of some logical operator symbols and the content of cell F3. So if I open up the double quotes, put greater than or equal to, because if the sale is exactly 2,500, I want that included, close the double quotes, ampersand to join or concatenate the content of cell F3. That is our criteria. Close bracket for COUNTIF and enter brings us the answer of 8. And because we have referenced cell F3, we know that we could change this to 3,000 and our formula would work with that condition. Let me change it back to 2,500 because that is the goal of this challenge at the start. The final test is to create that chart, and then we will test out what we have built. For the chart, I'm going to select the range from the cell region in F6 down to the last cell value in cell G10, and it's insert, and I'm going straight for the column chart button. We can use this recommended charts button, but I know I want a column chart, so I'm coming straight for the first column chart. We get a standard looking column chart in there, covers some of the values that we want. So if I drag it down a little bit, because I want my chart title to use the cell value of F5. So if I click on my chart title, type equals, and then click that cell, I can see in the formula bar I have built a reference to that cell. So pressing enter, I now have a meaningful chart title. We can make any other improvements that we want to this chart. Some of the improvements mentioned on the course were to remove the axes and the grid lines. So I can click on the axes, the value axes, and delete. Click on a grid line and delete. And then add in some data labels. If I click the plus sign on the right of the chart and tick data labels, I won't concern myself with specifying a position. I'm happy with the above the series option, which is provided by default. We can then decrease the width between the columns by right mouse clicking a column, formats data series, and decreasing this gap width, currently set to 219%. And I think I'll make it 120% and see what that looks like. And I'm happy with that. I will close down that pane, resize my chart a little, and position it underneath my sales analysis data. And now let's see if it works when the new data is added using the test data provided. To do that quickly, I can select the range of test data, grab the border of that range, and drag it to the bottom of the table in row 18. As soon as I release it there, the table will recognize the new data added and auto expand. And because our formulas and then therefore our chart is using that table data, they have also updated. You probably saw the chart change, but when we look at the formulas too, you can see that the number of sales has increased to 10. Two new sales from that test data met or exceeded the target of 2,500. So I hope you enjoyed that challenge. Testing yourself and working with challenges like this is a great way to learn and develop your Excel skills.
So did you get the same results? Share your take on the challenge in the comments below, or join us for more discussion in our Slack channel, link in the description. Thanks for participating in this challenge, and make sure to subscribe to this channel to get an alert when the next one is released.